And we talk about visibility, and it's one of the challenges, I think, of working, and we work deliberately and specifically around sexual diversity and gender diversity. Not all forms of diversity, we're talking about sexual diversity and gender diversity. And both of those things are not necessarily visible. You can't look around the room and be like, oh, you're sexually diverse, you're gender diverse, whatever. It's not the same as saying, oh, there's a lot of people from different cultural backgrounds, I can see them in here. Not all cultural diversity is visible, but there, you know, there are those triggers to make you think, are we doing stuff to make those students from different cultural backgrounds feel included? There's not the same triggers around sexual diversity. People can be invisible, and there are schools where they say, still, we don't necessarily work with them, but we hear the stories of, but we don't really have any gay students in our school. Because they're not necessarily visible, right? So we've got to think about really explicit, visible cues that are very clearly about gender and sexual diversity. So we think very specific posters work really well. Very specific messages from school leadership. Very specific things written in your school newsletter about Safe Schools Coalition is about supporting gender and sexual diversity. Not about celebrating diversity, not about stopping bullying, about gender and sexual diversity, about same-sex attractive, about being transgender, about being lesbian, gay, bisexual, say the words, transgender, intersex, not just be nice to everyone, everyone's great.
And I think that's come out of, like, in the past schools, like, and schools still do.
Positive parents have kind of driven that change in schools. And out of 132 schools, we have had one complaint from a parent about being part of Safe Schools Coalition. One complaint. And that's not what the schools thought was going to happen. All of the school leadership, a lot of school leadership said, oh, what can we do when a parent complains? We give them some advice, and then we're like, did anyone complain? I'm like, no, it's great actually. Somebody called us and said, congratulations for joining. And it's way more likely to be that we find than people complaining. If and when, and sometimes in that case when the parent did complain, we have complaints sometimes directly from parents who are not interested in learning. When people do complain, and school leadership can very calmly and graciously say, you know what we're doing anyway, tough luck, basically, in a nice way. What can you do? This is a program that's about supporting safe and inclusive schools. We're going to celebrate Idaho Day, and we're going to do it with our junior campus. And so, it's unfortunate that you don't agree with that. We're going to do it again next year. If you really strongly disagree and you want to take your kid out of school that day, that's their loss, really.
That's what they said to the parents. It's important to know that it does come up a lot. People say, what about the parents a lot? Schools think that parents seem to have a lot of power over schools. Parents don't have the power to shut this down. There's an insignificant minority that might have an issue with it. None of them could really ever say anything. I have one person that does. The principal knows how to deal with that person. They know what the message is. They know why they're doing this work and why it's so important. That's part of the school culture. That's part of the school community. You're either part of it or you're not, really, at the end of the day. And no one's taking a kid out of the school that belongs to the coalition for that reason.
And you would, and I know